I Brooklyn. Fulton Street, my head. Best Eye, my heart. Subway, my veins. My love is all. Question it, you do. Where's your soul? My soul is Prospect Park. My name is Keon Martin, and I'm a screenwriter and director from Brooklyn, New York. Recently, during these past few months, I've learned of a small town where Black Americans own successful businesses, private planes, private bus lines, as well as their own school system. Now, this may sound far-fetched in today's time, but back in the early 1900s, this was reality for a small Black community in Greenwood, Tulsa, Oklahoma, better known by the New York Financial District as
Black Wall Street.
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 Did you have any knowledge of it?
No.
The light is there. You see, I come from Mississippi. I was young and running wild. Ended up in New York City, where I had my first child. I named the boy Nasir. All the boys call him Nas. I told him as a youngster, he'll be the greatest man alive.
Let's go.
I'm the magnificent.
Hey, Chuck Berry of this rap skit. Styles I mastered, many brothers snatched it up and tried to match it. But I'm still number one, everyday real. Speak what I want, I don't care what y'all feel, cause I'm my own master. My pop told me be your own boss, keep integrity at every cost. And his home was Natchez, Mississippi. Did it like Miles and Dizzy, now we getting busy. Bridging the gap from the blues to jazz to rap. The history of music on this track. Born in the game, discovered my father's music like Prince searching through boxes of purple rain.
Hey yo, 1, 2, 3. Uh-huh. The crew is called Refugees. And if you come for test the rap style.
Black Wall Street started with a bunch of African Americans and Native Americans on a piece of land that was flourishing with oil.
It was a group of several millionaires in, if I'm mistaken, Greenwood, Oklahoma.
There were millionaires, Black millionaires in this area, you know, people that had, you know, access and ownership of their own private airplanes and, you know, different type of cars and just living lavish, living well, say, you know, taking trips, you know, to Paris to go shop. And
this was around the 1920s, and there were doctors, lawyers, airline companies. They had their own. They owned their own little area. It was 36 square blocks or something like that. And
they had their own businesses, and they, you know what I mean? We kept all the money circulating in our own community. They had schools and everything like that.
Everyone helped each other, and, you know, they were all making, you know, their own money and keeping the money within the community. From what I understand, like, $15 would circulate at least 30 to 100 times before it left the community.
They were forced to keep the money inside their community. Whoever came up with that harebrained outside of the community was absolutely crazy.
The Black Wall Street community was about Black empowerment in the face of 1921 Jim Crow laws, segregation laws that really marginalized economically the Black community. We had a community of Blacks who understood that they had to become self-sufficient. And instead of money going outside, there was money coming into the community and exchanging hands.
There was even talks of them, you know, bartering for different goods. You know, a blacksmith would help someone in the fruit stands and things of that nature. And that goes beyond business. You know, especially when you're dealing with people of the same culture.
We loaned each other. We were, you know, churches were also large financial institutions. It was like, I'm gonna take this tithe and offering money. We're gonna flip that money, and we're gonna buy you a tractor. We're gonna take that tractor. You're gonna make some corn. We're gonna sell that corn to somebody else, and we're gonna take that money. We're gonna buy some fuel. He's gonna run the gas station with it.
one of those kind of relationships where if someone's house would burn down, the next couple of weeks it would be rebuilt by all the neighbors, and everyone just, it was like a pitch-in effort, you know. It's similar to times that you hear about from like your grandparents, and when they say like things were better back then. Well, you know, our grandparents, they were probably going to like the 40s and 50s. You have to remember this happened in, you know, the early 1900s.
It was in a hotel, and inside of an elevator, it was a white woman and a couple black men in the elevator. Media, you know, had got hold of what happened on this elevator, and they blew it totally out of proportion. And to my understanding, what they did was they switched it back to the Emmett Till. They switched it and made it seem like the black businessman in the elevator was trying to talk to the white woman. So the media gets it, they put it out there. The Ku Klux Klan, they get wind of it, they mount up.
There were reports of aerial bombs. Like, that's preparation. You can't have something spark at 1 o'clock, you know, and then 7:30 is bombing. That, come on, man. That's pre-planned in my eyes. Or that's you getting word to people in a higher position than who's ever having issues on the street.
It took all of 12 hours to destroy 36 square blocks of land, and they dropped a bomb. And
I think it was jealousy, a jealousy that was brewing all along. The Ku Klux Klan, of course, was very heavily involved in initiating a lot of the violence that came about. You know, but it's the same old story. Let's put a white woman attacked by a black man, and now we've got the makings of everything that we need to create violence and justification for the white community to attack the black community.
People fear what they don't understand, hate what they can't conquer. Guess it's just the fury of man became a monster atop of the world.
A community of blacks empowered as they were there economically, it would be a threat to the surrounding white communities, especially if they're not experiencing the same level of economic progress.
The flourishing black community was a threat because, you know, you have a group of educated black people around that time. You know, they weren't used to us being educated. With education comes power, with money comes power, and so this was now an evolving, emerging, powerful group of African Americans, something that they had never seen before. So of course, you know, they were put off by that. You know, these were people that had good sense, you know, so to speak, and people that would be able to challenge some of their, you know, some of the Jim Crow issues and things of that nature.
When you think about a people that you write off and you cast off and you put them in some remote area in Tulsa, you know, Greenwood to be exact, and you feel like, you know, they will have to live off the land the best they could, and they actually turn out to be better than what you have, that's a problem. That's not even a threat. That's a problem.